Now let's turn to number 170 in our hymnals as we stand and sing together, Down at the Cross, 170. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where from cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was some blood applied, glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name, there to my heart was some blood applied, glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin, Jesus so sweetly abides within, there at the cross where he took me in, glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name, there to my heart was the blood applied, glory to his name, O precious fountain that saved from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was a blood. Fountain so rich and sweet, cast your poor soul at the Savior's feet, plunge in today and be made complete, glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to
sing is glory to his name, glory forever, every day to his name. Amen. If you look around this morning, you see lots of folks missing today. A lot of folks are sick, couldn't be here today. Sandy's sick, got heart problems this week, and then stomach virus or whatever that is. And I see lots of folks who are out with the stomach issues. Some have been in the hospital this week. Lucille's at home. But I want you to do an exercise with me this morning. Everybody ready to do an exercise with the preacher? Hold your hand out just like this. Your right hand. Just like this. Shake. Now don't go out here and say that old preacher didn't shake my hand. I'm trying my best to be careful between now and surgery time. And so I've had the advice of several of you people of great wisdom tell me, I'm not shaking your hand. And that's okay. We just shook hands. But we'll do that for the duration of this illness times for everybody. And so it's up to you if you like to shake hands. Just go ahead and do it with each other. But I just shook your hand this morning, okay? Let's worship the Lord with the giving of our tithes and offerings. Brothers, would you come? Brother Bill, would you ask the blessing?
Praise the Father, thank you, Lord, your God, this
Amen. Brother Harry, Sister Becky,
I'd like to say I sincerely enjoyed Sister Martha's presentation.
Amen.
Although I couldn't see the screen, I heard what she said, and it was a real blessing to me.
Amen.
Well, I'm beside myself, although I look the same. The portrait that I usually is in a different frame. Feels a strength, but I'm as helpless as a child. You may see me grin like it's going out of style.
The things I used to treasure
just get in the way. The people I once hated, I love them more each day. The frown I'm used to wearing has been turned upside down since Jesus came into my heart and turned my life around. He lives in me. He lives in me. He bought me with a price,
and I no longer am my own.
My life is his kingdom. My heart is his throne. He lives in me. He lives in me. Oh, the King of all heaven and earth is living in me. Well, even when I'm tempted, good and evil are at war. The battle's getting harder than it's ever been before. Well, I know where my strength lies. I can't do it on my own. And I get reinforcement cause I'm never left alone. He lives in me. He lives in me. He bought me with a price, and I no longer am my own. My life is his kingdom. My heart is his throne. He lives in me. He lives in me. Well, the King of all heaven and earth is living in me. Oh, he lives in me. He lives in me. He bought me with a price, and I no longer am my own. My life is his kingdom. My heart is his throne. He lives in me. He lives in me. King of all heaven and earth is living in me. Yes, the King of all heaven and earth is living in me.
Amen. I'm glad that when he came in, the devil had to flee. He lives within us if you're saved and you're his child. Open your Bibles this morning to Ephesians chapter 3 and Luke chapter 5, or take the insert out of your bulletin. Sister, do you have a bulletin? You have a bulletin this morning. Matthew, you need a bulletin down front. We got one here. Okay. But the insert in your bulletin or turn to, in your Bibles to Ephesians 3 and Luke chapter 5. Enjoy the trio now as they come to sing. Comes in, he makes a difference in everybody's lives. I read a thing the other day that one of the old scholars said if the grace that saved you can't be the grace that changes you, then you need to see if you're living in the right grace. I tell you, God makes a difference every time he comes in. Be much in prayer for our doctrinal class on Sunday nights. Especially tonight. Now the devil's going to do everything he can to keep you from being here tonight. I mean, everything in his power. He's done everything in the last few weeks to stop the message from being going forth tonight. If you haven't been coming to the class tonight, you ought to come. I'm going to tell you why. We're talking about the devil tonight. Meeting your adversary, the devil. In all of my years of ministry, I have never, ever preached on Satan or taught on Satan, but what he didn't fight us for a month, 6 weeks beforehand. I prayed this morning, Lord, let everybody be here tonight. Let me teach this message so that Satan will go home and leave us alone. I really, really mean that too. Launch out into the deep. It's what children of God needs to do. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18 through 21, and Luke 5, 1 through 11. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 3. May be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that ye may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Unto him be glory in the church by Jesus Christ throughout the ages, throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. One thing that really concerns me as a pastor, as your pastor, as a preacher of the gospel, is that too many Christians are walking around in shallow water, ankle deep water. I really believe it's God's will that all of his children know and understand what the breadth, length, depth, and height of the love of God for us is, the love of Christ for us. Sad to say, too many Christians today say, well, I know that I'm saved because God loved me. And that's as far as they ever get in their service with God. They never receive the great blessings that they should be receiving in their lives. That really concerns me as a pastor, as your pastor. You see, I want God's best for you. I want you to have every bit of the blessings of God that God intends for you to have. I want us to enjoy the riches of God in Christ Jesus for us. So let's look at Luke chapter 5. Find out how today. Verse 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the side of the lake Generous and saw two ships standing by in the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them, for they were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed that he would thrust out a little from land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep, and let down the nets for a draw. Simon answered and said, Master, we have toiled all night, and taketh nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Let me read it in the way that I would have responded as Peter did. This would be the most of our response. Christ tells us to thrust it, to launch out a little bit further, to let it down into the deep. And I would have looked at him and said, Master, don't you understand? I'm tired. I'm worn out. I can't. You see, I've been fishing all night. I've thrown that net out and brought it in, so much. I can't do it. I just no fish around here, Master. But Peter answered with the right words. He says, nevertheless, at thy word, because you say so, I'll let down the net. And when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And he beckoned unto their partners, which were in another ship, that they should come alongside and help. And they came, and they filled both ships, and they began to sink. And Simon Peter saw it. He fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the drought which the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John and the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, Fear not, from henceforth I shall catch men. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. Let us pray. Father, our hearts are just overjoyed this morning at who you are. God, the only God, the amazing God. We're overjoyed at the fact that your Son loved us so much that he gave himself at Calvary to save our souls from hell. We are amazed at what you want for us today, the blessings you want to send our way, and what we need to do to obtain those blessings. So, Father, I pray, Lord, that you take these feeble words that we speak, honor the Word of God. Holy Spirit, place this in our hearts and our minds that we might leave changed people. If there's any lost, that they'll come to know you as their Savior. In Christ's name, amen. That you may know the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height of the love of God, launch out into the deep. As I look in my mind's eye at this day when Christ came to this huge mass of people beside the lake, how glorious it must have been to see all these people coming, pressing, pushing, just to get close to Christ, just to get closer to Him, just to hear His words, just to hear Him teach the words of God. You see, up until the coming of John the Baptist and then Jesus Christ, it had been approximately 400 years of silence from heaven. No prophet or teacher speaking from God, for God. As I read this, I prayed this prayer, Lord, don't ever be silent with me. Don't ever remove your word from me. I think it must be one of the worst things in the world for heaven to be silent, as it was for 400 years. But it appears now that the people were thirsting and hungering for something to soothe the burning and the emptiness of their heart, their soul, their life. Oh, that today, we could see a desire and a thirsting of souls for the Word of God. However, it's sad as it is, I believe that there's a silence of the true Word of God in many pulpits today. I really do. I believe that. I believe there's a great silence, a great drought of the preaching of the Word of God, the whole counsel of the Word of God, the thoughts of God from heaven for men and women and boys and girls today. I think in many pulpits around this nation today, it's silent. That's sad. We want to talk about everything God wants us to talk about. We want to have a formalistic church without the power of God. He said it would be that way in the last days. How sad it is in the day that we're living, when there's very few preachers who preach sin black, hell long, hot, eternity long, and that there's a forgiveness for all those who come to God through Christ Jesus. I thought something else. Blessed are the problems of life that causes one to seek to hear the words of God. You say, preacher, you don't know what I'm going through. Could it be that God wants you to go through it, that you might come closer to Him, that you might listen to Him instead of the other things of the world? That we find a remedy and a cleansing for sin that has captured the souls of many and made them empty and thirsty. Christian, maybe I would ask you this question. Do you remember when you were empty and thirsty and needed something to fill your heart and you came because of the Word of God? That somebody preached to you, somebody taught you, somebody shared with you? I don't understand why God does a lot of things in the life of His children, and allow a lot of things to happen in the life of His children. But I do know this. I have never been through a problem in my life. I've never been through a trial in my life. I've never been through troubles in my life. But what it did not bring me closer to Christ. Could it be that's what He's doing for us today? People search everywhere in many places, leaving themselves empty and thirsty. They go everywhere except for the house of God, to listen to everything except for the Word of God, and they stay thirsty and empty. But Christ alone knows how to speak the words of grace to the weary and downtrodden. You see, for the words of grace and truth can only come from His lips. John writes to us in chapter 1, verse 14, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. You see, without coming to Christ, there is no truth. Without Christ, there is no grace. Without Christ, there is no healing for your problems. There is no balm in Gilead. There is no soothing for the sin-sick soul, for the weary Christian, for the one who's been downtrodden. But here today, we find some very interesting things about going deeper with God. You see, at the end of this message, my hope is that you'll know God, know Christ just a little bit better. That you'll be able to comprehend the depth and the height and the length and the width of God's great love for us through Christ and what He wants to do for us. The first thing I noticed in studying this particular passage of Scripture in Luke, I see a devoted possession. I see a possession that someone had that he didn't mind using for Christ and for His glory. Look with me in verse 3. And he entered into the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land, and he sat down and talked with the people out of the ship. You said Christ could, in His greatness, in His magnificent person who He was, being God in human flesh, He could stood on the sands of the shore and elevated His voice to a particular height that it needed to be, and everybody could see Him. Yes, He could. But in all the teaching, listen, in all the teaching and all the words that Christ was saying, He had a meaning for one person. We'll find that out today. So Simon launched out a little bit from land, and Christ sat and talked there. We don't find everything that He spoke. We don't find everything that He talked, but it made the heart of many people happy. You see, one thing I see about this is Peter had made himself his ship ready for the Master's use. Here you find Peter and John and James, the son of Zebedee, who had been fishing all night. They were tired. All of them had left their boats except Peter to go mend their nets. Christ just happens to step into the boat of Peter. No, Christ purposely stepped into the boat of Peter. Oh, what an honor to be the means of helping Christ reach all the hungry and thirsty souls. And He did this through Peter's ship. Church, do you realize what an honor it is for us to be used, or to use our possessions, to use all that God's blessed us with, all He's given us with, to reach souls for Him, to make a difference in somebody's life? As I asked you this morning, how's this same Jesus to reach the millions of lost, seeking souls today? It has to be much in the same manner through our possessions, through what He's blessed us with. You see, but even today, there's only a few people who will give their all of their possessions to Christ, that He may reach the lost and dying people of the world. Barner says this in a recent poll. They asked people how much they've given of their life to Christ and how much of their possessions and things that they own is used for Him and His glory. Surprisingly, less than 1% of all the people that call themselves Christians says everything I have is at His disposal. May I tell you this morning, not being smart, not being nasty, but if you have anything that you call your own that you can't use for the glory of God, you need to get rid of it. You don't need it. Your house, your cars, your time, your telephones. And we could go on and on and on and on. If you can't use it for God's glory, you don't need it. But everything that we have needs to be available to Him for His use, and you'll never receive great blessings until you learn that teaching, that lesson. You see, Peter's willingness to give his ship to be used by Christ brought him great rewards, even in this life, by a great amount of fishes that he caught, but in the teachings of Jesus Christ. Peter called to his brethren, we'll talk a little bit more about this in a minute, and said, come and help me. My net's breaking. I've got more fish than I know what to do with. What a blessing. You see, if he had never launched out just a little bit further, first of all, if he had never gave Christ his boat to be used, moved out a little bit further to shore, obeyed his word, and launched into the deep and let down his nets, he would have never known the blessings in this world. I want to tell you, God's got blessings on top of blessings on top of blessings for His people if we'd only believe and do His work and His will. But the greater blessing, more than the fishes, was when Christ looked at Peter and said this in verse 10. Simon, Simon, fear not, for from now on you're going to catch men. You've been used to fishing, but from now on you're going to catch men. Isn't that what our life is about anyhow? Isn't that what God wants us to be about anyhow? You see, beloved, we do not need to boast about our possessions. The possessions that we have, those things that we enjoy, if we're not giving them back to Christ in His ministry work. If we're not giving all of our possessions to Him to use as He sees fit, then we're robbing God and robbing our own selves, and our possessions will not profit us. We're reminded in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 8, will a man rob God? Ye have robbed me. But where have we robbed you? We have robbed you in tithes and offerings. The question I asked this morning, which I've asked to myself earlier and I asked to you this morning, are we allowing Christ to use all that God has blessed us with to reach the souls around us and to encourage the hurting today? You see, we need to have a twofold ministry, and everything we have, it needs to be involved in it. Everything we have needs to be used for God's glory in winning souls. In winning souls. And then we need to use everything we have in encouraging saints, edifying, lifting up the brethren. So first of all, we see that Peter gave his ship to be used to the Master. What are we giving Christ to be used by Him? Secondly, we see not only a devoted possession given to Christ, but we see a gracious commission. Look in verse 4. Now when he had left off speaking or teaching to the multitude, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draw. Launch out and let down. That's what Christ is telling us to do. Launch out and let down. You see, when Christ takes our possessions, he also gives us his commission. Maybe you're here this morning, you're sitting and fretting and worrying about your own weakness. Launch out into the deep divine strength of Christ. When I talk to many Christians about living the Christian life and about what they need to be doing for God and his glory and how they need to be letting God use them, I hear this one reply. Many times have I heard this reply, but oh, Pastor, I can't. Pastor, I'm not able. Pastor, I'm not equipped. All I ask is this, are you available? Are you available? I said the other day, and I'll say again tonight, this morning, I heard Dr. Billy Graham's son describe him as this. Dr. Billy Graham was fat. He was fat. He was faithful, he was available, and he was teachable. God help me to be fat for him. If you're worrying and fretting about your weaknesses, God has this divine strength in Jesus Christ for you. If you're here in despair over your unworthiness, launch out into the deep areas of God's infinite love and let down your nets of trust. Because Ephesians chapter 3 is what we need to know, that you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Pastor, I'm unworthy. If Christ has made you whole, if Christ has saved your soul, if grace has been applied to your life, you're the most worthy person in the world to be used of God. Just make yourself available. You see, only by being used of God and only making yourself available to Him will you ever know God's the depths of the love of Christ for you. And by the way, I'm still learning every day of my life how much He loves me, how much He cares for me, how deep He'll go for me, to the extent of His love that He shows to me. We're all still learning as Christians, and the further we go with Him and the more available we make ourselves to Him, the more we learn that. If you're waiting lazily in ankle-deep waters of your feelings, launch out into the deep of God's faithfulness. But preacher, I just don't feel like God can use me. Devil, go home. But preacher, I'm just not capable. Devil, go home. But preacher, devil, go home. Leave God's children alone. Let them get busy for God. Let them learn. You see, he wants to rob you of your learning ability of the grace and the love of Christ for you. Launch out into the deep waters where you'll find great blessings, great fishes for today, and great blessings for tomorrow and the future. Because in those deep waters, you'll find God's footprints that you've never seen before. Psalmist David puts it this way in 197:24. These see the works of God and the wonders in the deep. If you want to find God's blessings for your life, become available and be usable by Him. Sometimes, a lot of times, and I started not to insert this paragraph, sometimes God allows us preachers and teachers, as He did Paul, to spend a day and the night in the deep before coming to God's people with a heartfelt of deep treasures for God's Word. Let me see if I can put it to you this way you understand. I know Pat and Jean will understand it. They're pastor's daughters. Sometimes God allows His preachers to spend some awful nights and awful days, and it seems like drowning waters. Seems like we can't get our head out of the water to take a breath before bringing the message of God and His love to His people. This has been one of those weeks, folks. But I was determined this morning when I got up and got dressed that I was going to bring this message to God's people. Because I want to show you something this morning about launching out into the deep and learning and knowing the love of God through Christ Jesus that He has for you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 9 through 10, we see this used at a lot of funerals, but this is not a funeral message. But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, nor hath entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him. But God hath revealed it to us by His Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. It doesn't matter what God's men have to go through. It doesn't matter what God's preachers have to go through if they have the right heart. What matters is that you see how much God loves you. You see how much God can use you and your faithfulness. You see how much God can do for you and your family and your home if you'll just give it all to Him as your possessions. If you'll follow His commission to be fishers of men. If you'll just give everything that you have to Him and His gracious commission to you. Because God will take you to the deep things that He wants you to have in your life. He'll bless you more than you've ever known blessings to be. He'll give you more than you'll ever be able to understand through His love. Question is, are we following in obedience the glorious commission of Christ, letting Him use us in all that we have? Next, I see a man on his knees. I see a humbling profession, a confession in verse 5. And Simon answered unto him, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Toiled all night, taking nothing. Are you weary in well-doing? Word of God says, be not weary in well-doing. Do you think I've done all that I can? Maybe I just need to quit. Never quit on God. It is always a trying time after doing all that you can, toiling day and night, working to catch men, to see people come to know Christ, to see those who come to know Christ discipled, and you look around you and you've taken nothing. Oh, there's times that I feel this way. There's times I feel that way. I'm sure there's times that you as Christians feel that way. But then I'm reminded by the love of Christ. All is not lost. Take heart, all is not lost. For even when we think this, we're in better condition than we were before by giving Him glory and receiving His blessings. Are we ashamed to confess our failures in our past? Christian, don't ever be ashamed to confess your failures. Confess them to God. Confess them to God. That's what Peter done, Simon done. Would we try to hide the fact that our labor has produced no fruit? That we've worked hard and not produced what we hoped we would produce? No, no, no. Never be ashamed of what you're doing for God. Never be ashamed of what you're doing for God. I tell you, with all that's in our heart, keeping back nothing, that's what we need to tell to Jesus. You say, I can tell Jesus that? He already knows it. He already knew what Peter was going to say. He knows everything about you and I and what our response is going to be. Tell Him everything that's in your heart. Don't hold back anything. Just give Him everything. Christ alone has the remedy for our weakness and our needed strength to continue to work for Him and His kingdom. You see, when we do this, confess, Lord, I'm tired. I fished all night. I've worked for years in the church. I've visited. I've witnessed. We've done everything in our community we know to do to fill up your house. We've done everything we know to do to win the lost, even at any cost. We've given you everything we've got, and we're heavy-hearted. This verse was not in the original outline that I typed up. But about 3:00 yesterday morning, Friday morning, it seems like just out of the blue. This is where it pays to remember the Word of God and hide it in your heart. I heard David saying in Psalms 30, "Hear, O Lord, and have mercy on me. Lord, be thou my helper. Thou hast turned me from my mourning into dancing, and thou hast put off my sackcloth and girded me with thy gladness." You see, we need to understand that to the end of, that my glory may sing praise to thee and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thee thanks unto thee forever. When it seems like we've done all that we could do, we've been in the harvest fields working, we've been knocking on doors, we've been visiting our community, we've been telling the lost about Christ, we've been sending the message around the community through TV and internet, around the state and around the world. When it seems like we've done all and we haven't accomplished what we really thought we should accomplish, hear the Lord say, "Well done. You've done what I asked you to do." He'll take that mourning and turn it into happiness, into gladness. He'll take that attitude of sackcloth and ashes and unworthiness and turn it into joy, into dancing. What a great joy it is just to confess to Christ, "Not I, but you. I can't do it, but you can." The question is, how long has it been since we've made a confession of this nature to Christ? How long has it been since we've told Him all of that we need to tell Him and known the joy that comes from such a confession? The altar is open anytime you need to talk to Christ. We see not only these things, but we see a God-honoring resolution. Look in verse 5. "Nevertheless, at thy word, I will." Nevertheless, that's not important how I feel, Lord. It's not important that I'm tired and weary and worn out. It's not important that I've done all that I've been doing. It's not important. You see, I'm not important. We need to understand one thing, Christian. I'm not important in the work of God. It's Christ that's important in the work of God working through us. We just need to make me available to Him, I available to Him, and then we'll be important. Nevertheless, I've heard you teach the masses. I've heard your message today, Lord, that you echoed on the side of the hill from sitting in my boat. So by faith, I'm going to obey you and launch out into the deep. The path of victory is one of faith and obedience. You see, Peter's feelings is just what I just said. It's no use. I fished all night and I've taken no fish. But Peter's faith said in obedience to Christ's command, nevertheless, at thy word, I will. What are we going to follow, our feelings or our faith in Christ? It's the big question. To this point, there was no discussion that needed to be had. It was simply needed to be, the words of Christ were simply needed to be believed. Are we going to let our past hinder our present or our future endeavors for Christ? No. No, no. But like Simon Peter, we need to make a fresh start today and obey and understand the authority of God's word. Peter found faith to launch out. He also found faith through the word of God. Nevertheless, I will. Those who obey and go out at his word will find great reason to praise him coming back to his house. The question is, are we struggling ourselves? Are we still struggling ourselves, thinking it's our way and our own efforts that will bring God's blessings to us? How much better way is it than at thy word, I will? You can do all you want to do in yourself and have nothing. You can do all you want to and enjoy no blessings from God. But once you say, at your word, I will, blessings will flow. And then we see an amazing satisfaction. Verse 6. And when this is done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net break. You see, this time, Simon Peter was more successful fishing out of season than in season. As I went back and looked at where they were fishing and the different seasons of time, it's believed that he was fishing at night because that's the time that the fish were in that particular location. In another season, they may have fished during the day because they was in a different location. But Peter's fishing out of season was just as good or better than it was in season. Is it any wonder Paul instructed young Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:4, preach the word, be instant in season and out of season? I want to tell you, if God said preach it, in season, out of season. The words of Christ believed made all the difference. He just believed what Christ said. If you want blessings in your life, just believe what Christ says and do what Christ instructs us to do. Soul-satisfying fullness can only be enjoyed when we do the things His way, according to His will, and with His presence, with His guidance. May we, at this church, we as individual Christians, not let our habits and our forms and our customs, however good they may be, stand in the way of doing what we know is to be the will of God. May we follow Him and know His satisfaction of bringing satisfaction to our longing hearts, as Psalmist David said in 107:9, for He satisfieth the longing soul and filleth the hungry with goodness. As a pastor of your church, God's church, this church, I've had to ask myself the question lately several times. Are we letting our habits, our forms, our customs, our traditions, however good they are, stand in the way of doing what we know to be His will? I told the class the other night, one of the things that worries me the most, or bothers me the most, not what worries me, but bothers me the most, in our modern age of Christianity, is letting worldliness creep into the church in many different various forms and ways. You see, regardless of our customs, regardless what we think, regardless what we want, this is what we need to be guided by. This is what we need to be obeying. And as your pastor, sometimes it's hard to get those things out of the way or keep those things in the way, not to become worldly and bothered by the things of this world. The question is this to us individually: are we allowing our personal habits, our personal forms and customs to keep us from doing the will of God? That's a big question for Christians today. Am I letting me and what I think and what I like and what I do stand in the way of me doing what God wants me to do? I can't answer that except for me. You need to answer it for yourself. And then we see one other thing. We see brotherly cooperation in verse 7. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they would come and help them. And they came and filled both ships, and they began to sink. They beckoned unto their other partners, come and fill both ships. Had they not invited their brothers to come and help them, much fish would be lost. They would have lost the great blessings. Church, I want you to hear this statement, individually and collectively. I wonder how much is being lost today in Christian work because the lack of Christian union and unity. What hinders this union of Christian cooperation? Could it be selfish pride, wanting to build a name for ourselves or our church, or waiting to be the one? I want to be the one. I want to be one of many. I want us to work together as we've never worked before. I want us to pull the weight together as we never pulled it before. Others are needed besides us in this work of the brethren, and I want us to unite together and do more than we've ever done before, not only in this church, but with other churches around us. Let me say, as your pastor this morning, look at me. I want everybody looking at me this morning for just a minute. Let me say, as your pastor, I need you. Listen to this. Christ needs you. More than ever. You see, I want us to be able to share in the joy of bringing souls to Christ, being fishers of men. I want us to enjoy the blessings today of bringing souls to Christ, but I want us to enjoy the blessings that will continue forever and ever and ever by we seeing those people in heaven. Everyone's needed. If you're sitting here this morning and you say, that church doesn't need me, devil, go home. You tell him. If he ever sits on your shoulder and says, that church don't need you, I can't do this, I can't. Devil, go home. I've told him that 1,000 times this week, it seems like. Devil, go home. Leave me alone. Leave my church alone. Leave my family alone. You're not wanted there. You're not welcome there. But listen, I'll repeat it one time. This pastor needs you. Christ needs you. And oh, what a joy it would be if we in this church work together greater than we ever have to see a harvest of souls come to know Christ. The question is this: are we laboring alone and gaining nothing? Then why not join together with your brothers and sisters in Christ for a harvest of souls? And then I see a complete consecration in verse 11. And when they were brought to ships, the land, they forsook all and followed him. They forsook all and followed him. One would think, one would may be okay to believe that Peter and these others had enough to satisfy them for a while. They didn't need to work anymore. They didn't need to fish anymore. But see, they learned a lesson that they had never seen in their life before. They'd been busy fishing in the wrong place. They'd been busy fishing in the wrong place. But Christ was getting ready to give them a new lake to fish in, a new sea to fish in. And he says, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. Boy, that must have been an amazing word to hear from Christ, because they forsook all when they came to land. They said, there's my boat, there's my nets, somebody else can use those, I'm following this man Jesus. Peter says, I've already given it to him, he can give it to whoever he wants to. I'm following this man Jesus. How long has it been since we made that confession of faith? How long has it been since we made that determination of heart and soul and spirit? that there's nothing else greater to live for than to be a fisher of men. There's nothing else greater to bring blessings in our heart than to see somebody come to know Christ as their Savior and their Lord, to see families united, to see families restored, to see families brought back to serving God. There's nothing greater. May I tell you this morning, there's not a person sitting in this pew in this church this morning who could not be used of God to see that happen. Every family in this church this morning has got somebody in their family that's lost. Amen? Every family sitting in the person sitting in this church this morning has got somebody that's wandering away from their profession of faith in Christ. Everybody's got somebody in their family that's not living for Christ the way they should. And it's our job to follow Christ and be fishers of men to bring them in to God's fold. Paul wrote to the Philippian church and he said this, "Brethren, I count myself, count not myself to have obtained, to apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting all those things which are behind and reaching forward unto the things which are before, I press towards the mark of the high calling, of the prize of the high calling of God through in Christ Jesus." How long has it been since we gave him everything we have, fully consecrated ourselves and our possessions and all that we have for him and for his glory? Nothing can be done without him using us to be doing it. That's his way. The question is, where do you see yourself in this picture? Are you sitting boasting about the things of the past that you have done? Are you holding on to your possessions, not giving to Christ? Or are you fully following him? Only you can answer the questions that have been asked this morning. Heads bowed and eyes closed, the Jack and the ladies come. Where do you see yourself in the story? Have you given your possessions, all of them, to Christ for his use? Are you following Christ's commission for you? Are you cooperating with your church and a fellow brothers in Christ and sisters in Christ to bring the message of the gospel to the lost people around us in our hometown and around the world? Have you forsaken all? Only you can answer those questions. Only you can give them to God as the altar is open for God's people and for the lost to come. Father, take this message, use it for your glory. Work in the hearts of your people. May they respond according to your will and your leadership. In Christ's name, amen. Brother Jack?
596. Let's stand together.
If God's touched your heart and you see a need to be on the altar talking to Jesus, the altar is open.
How long has it been?